time.
Conquered the grave. He is David's root and
Sweet. of all blessing and honor.
Before you know it now, so come on, sing it out. I love to worship.
Well, Heavenly Father, we have gathered here today to do just that, to worship you, to come and to bow down before you, whether literally or figuratively, to come to your feet and to praise you simply for who you are. We are so grateful for the blessings that you pour on us, for the works you do in us and through us. But ultimately, you wouldn't have to do a thing, and you are still worthy of our praise simply for who you are. So as we gather like this today, and as we worship you and as we praise you, you care about us enough individually that you also desire to do a work in us. We thank you that as we come to worship you, you love us enough that you want to change us and mold us and shape us more and more into your image each and every day. And so today, Lord, we come carrying a lot of stuff. We got things that we've probably been asking you to do or in ways to move on our behalf. And I pray today, God, that of all those prayers that are being lifted up to you, all those individual needs and requests, God, that you would meet them according to your plan and your purpose and your will for each and every individual life. And Lord, we know that you don't bless us and you don't answer our prayers and move in spectacular ways just for us. It's so that we can carry your presence and be a light to the people around us. And we thank you that we get to come and gather with others today to be encouraged, to be challenged, to be strengthened so that we can move out and carry you to those we come in contact with. So Lord, we give you this day, we give you this time, we give you ourselves, and we come with humble and grateful hearts for who you are and for what you do. And one of the ways that we worship you, Lord, is to give back. You've provided in so many ways for all of us. Jehovah Jireh is one of your name, and it means that you're a provider. And Lord, it's a joy and a privilege to be able to give back to you what's really already yours to begin with, but to be able to give back in order to partner with you to further your kingdom and advance it here locally and around the world. So we thank you for that opportunity as well. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Our ushers are going to come to receive morning tithes and offerings, and know that there are many different ways that you can give around here, and they'll put some on the screen. But man, it's a joy to be able to give back after all that he's done for us. Amen? Amen. Give your attention to the screen, please.
I remember praying, okay, Lord, this is, we're taking the step, and here it is, it's final. But if I ever sense in my heart that you really want us to get back together, I'll do it. I said it sincerely, but I said it flip, like, I know you won't. But if you did, I want you to know, if you really made it clear, I would. I'd be willing. Little did I know.
So in April of 1990, my sister and brother-in-law came and packed up the kids and I, and we went home to be with my folks in Cuyahoga Falls.
And so I resigned, and with time off in the summer, but then I was, my oldest brother hired me to do multiple things at Coshocton. But they did it redemptively. I mean, they knew, and they talked about and prayed about as a board, and they felt like a mandate from the Lord that that's what they really wanted to do. And they were talking about reconciliation, some people that many would know. I didn't want to hear it, because I had my heart, no, you don't understand, you don't know what we've gone through. But they did it redemptively. They truly believed, there were prayer warriors that believed that God was going to use our appointment there to bring reconciliation. I didn't believe it, but they did.
I just felt like I was just healing over everything. I don't even know that I even thought about us ever getting back together again during that summer.
I had no hope of that there could be truly love and passion in our relationship again. It was too much hurt. And it's just after a time, you don't want to hurt anymore like that. You're tired of it. You're weary of it. I met a pastor's wife who had gone through a similar situation to me. She lived in California. She's really, truly was and is a fine lady. Mm-hmm. But that was so bonding, we got too close too soon, just because that similar background, and you have so much in common immediately in that bond, and that draws you deep conversation. And
I honestly remember feeling like I wasn't really upset about this person and him being together. I was okay with that until Christmas time came. Mm-hmm. And we would meet halfway between Akron and Coshocton to switch the kids. And I remember, and we had kind of a moment in the parking lot that day. And very tender moment. And I got extremely emotional. And so I had to drive 45 minutes home by myself, just bawling my eyes out, thinking, okay, this isn't right. My kids should not have to spend, you know, half and half, Christmas with me, Christmas with their dad. I just remember thinking, okay, and just really wrestling with the Lord over, you know, please change my feelings. I know this isn't right, but I still felt like I just didn't want to be with this man, you know? And then shortly after Christmas, was going to California and was going with his friend. And I began to think, okay, maybe this is really gonna, you know, something's really gonna happen here. And what's that gonna look like?
I thought so.
And so before he left, I remember I gave him a cassette of a song that I had heard that really felt like it described us. We had a discussion on the phone maybe about trying to put things back together again. So, and I remember him saying, okay, you know, yeah, I hear you, but I'm still gonna go on this trip. I'm still gonna do this, I've planned it, which I understood. I understood that. I didn't want him to go, but was gonna go. Well, I just prayed that he would just be sick the whole time he was there. He would be miserable.
Isn't that nice?
And he was. He ended up getting a really bad cold and
sinus.
Was pretty much in bed the whole time he was there, so he didn't have a really good time.
The big thing was, though, that I had a heart change in California. I mean, I was all excited, but I thought it was really going to go somewhere. But all I can say was my heart was drawn home while I was out there, and I knew before I ever headed back that I was going to head toward home. Towards home, not geographically, but in our hearts and family. It was like the Lord said, remember that vow, remember that commitment you made to me? It's time. And that led to basically a time we both remember in the kitchen of her parents' house, where we were talking at the table and said, we came to the agreement, mutual, that we're going to do this, we're going to reconcile. And we talked at that point without shame to this day, that we're going to do it for the Lord, we're going to do it for the kids, not for the easy,
not
that it would be an easy route for us,
right.
or the by any stretch.
I remember saying, okay, we're going to do this, and it might just be us. It might just be you and me doing this, you know, if we don't have all the support from family that we once did have.
But in the Lord's providence, we were not alone, and we got in a life-giving church where people loved us and cared for us and prayed for us and put up with us.
We separated in April, and our divorce was final in September. And by November or December, we were already starting to
draw back together. Believe me, it was a big deal. We lived it. It was hopeless, but look what God did.
And I've been having sinus problems ever since she prayed that I would be sick. It just clicked sitting there today. So you better reverse that prayer, would you? Did you rescind it? tender times. We lived it. We're not trying to celebrate our misery. We're trying to celebrate the goodness of God and his redemptive nature. The whole issue of this series is this, moving forward. Remember, we drew the first week that line from the vows, from this day forward. This is going to be a tough message. I'm going to bring it straight. And my prayer is, you may or may not like it, but my prayer is that you'll always know that you can come here and hear the truth. We won't compromise by culture. We're not going to cave. We're going to do our best to present
what we believe God would have us do. And it's from a pastor's heart of love. I began because everybody's impacted by marriage. I know it's tender. This is tough for us to sit here and watch this again. I mean, we have dreams and things about it, but our vulnerability helps one person, one family, it is worth it, I promise you. You don't want to miss next Sunday. Next Sunday, we're going to do some really neat, special things. Invite, bring people. We believe God's going to do something powerful in lives. He's doing it. We're hearing testimonies already, but even today, we could call for an immediate response, and we will, but I know over time, it takes time to sometimes process these things. But I started because we all deal with marriage. We're all impacted by it. And I know it's raw for some because of where you are, but we can all look. If we move forward without looking back, without learning from it, we're going to repeat the same thing again. We can look back and say, yep, there were some things missing that we could have done different. So the first week I talked about the fact that we need to go after God, and the takeaway for that was that we really need to be pray together, and I've got so much response that's happening, and I still encourage you. I know it's hard. It seems like it's particularly hard for guys, but why in the world wouldn't we? It's the best investment you can make. It doesn't cost a thing. Would you do that? The second week we talked about facing conflict, and we talked about the verse, remember, that said we're to be slow to speak, slow to get angry, we're to be quick to listen. And a very, very practical message series there about not ignoring it, but going after it. And then last week, we talked about smiling often, that God gave us relationships for joy, and that we shouldn't just live together and share space, but that we should live up to the standard that He has in mind for it. So today we're transitioning, and then probably my favorite of all will be next week, but today we're going to talk about staying clean, purity, about coming clean, and I think we need to hear it. Now, I've been thinking about all the marriages I've done, all the couples that I've dealt with over nearly 40 years of full-time ministry, and I don't know of anybody that has premeditated plans to say, I'm going to be faithful. We're getting married, but I'm going to be unfaithful. You know, I'm going to get in emotional trouble. I'm going to let lust rule, or I'm going to commit adultery. I don't know of anybody that pre-plans that, because people tend to look at marriages from my perspective as a brand new start, and an opportunity to maybe come clean, to go in a new direction from this day forward as we talk about it. Thoughts are never to damage, devastate, to destroy that union that's made before God. A man, for sure, no. But yet, it happens. It happens, and it often happens, and the percentages are staggering. It happens because people carry their baggage into marriages, right in their marriage relationship. It's just not that relationship, because if I know anything, I know this, that marriage doesn't fix you and marriage doesn't fix me. A lot of people think it will, but it doesn't. It almost magnifies the problems and the baggage that's there. When we're married, that relationship becomes an extension of who we are. So true. So we need to talk about coming clean, getting clean, staying clean. Hebrews 13:4, I direct you to this passage. Give honor to marriage and remain faithful to one another in marriage. God will surely judge people who are immoral and those who commit adultery. Very plain, very clear. That's not a very popular passage in our culture, but God's word doesn't change. It's not alters. So we should all give honor to marriage, because it's not a contract, it's a covenant. We talked about that. And it's God-initiated, it's God-sustained, it's God's idea, and it is to be kept pure and clean. So if I would ask, well, how many of you would raise your hand and say, yeah, adultery is not a good thing in marriage. Would everybody agree with that? It's hurtful. It's been done to you. You participated in it. It's so destructive. And it's interesting, because statisticians tell us, those who do polls, they say that it's actually on the rise, people in America who think adultery is wrong and say it. So ideologically, it's going up. But in practice, more and more people are committing adultery than ever. They say it's wrong, but they do it. They can't help it. So we want to talk about that. So first of all, let's just think about why impurity is increasing. And there are probably lots of reasons, but I would throw three out to you today. That number one, temptation is more accessible than ever before. You know, it's just like on Amazon, whatever, you know, you have the one click and you buy it. But it's like that for all kinds of things. I'm so thankful that I wasn't a teenager when I had all of these things. I had enough stuff to deal with without these added things. The Snapchats, all these things they invent where you send a picture, a message, something, and in a little while it's gone. On and on it goes. So you got to agree. And moms and dads, that's why we have to be so much on our toes, because it's everywhere. Everywhere. Man, I was a youth pastor for a lot of years, and I had enough struggles with youth, thinking about how would I be a youth pastor in this culture now with all the things that are availability and impurity increasing and with sanctioned by our culture. The second thing that I think is really a factor, and some of you are impacted by it, we're having prolonged adolescence nowadays. They say, I listened to several things on that just this last week, and they say that people are doing lots of things later in life. They're having kids a lot later, but they're getting married later in life. Unfortunately, they're still dating, and they're getting connected sexually with multiple partners, and that is so damaging, and they carry that into their relationship because there's ties of oneness, because God says when you bond in that way, there's oneness, and there are ties that have to be dealt with. So that's another thing. What I'm saying, I realize, goes against culture, but so many people now, how would I say it? They pretend they're married, and they do married things. That's not okay with God. It's not. That's not His plan for us. It's interesting to say, again, the people that study marriages and relationships, they say that the number one reason for breakup is people that are pretending they're married and they're living together. You know what the number one deal is? Cheating. That's what ends relationships. And we're also, by what we're accepting, we're training people for brokenness and divorce. And, you know, like, if you do get married, hey, just like, hey, if you're living together, something happens, you get rough, you just move out, you pack up and go your way. And people are carrying that into marriage. That was never God's intent. This is not a legalistic message. God said, I made you. I know how you tick. I want you to enjoy the gifts that I've given you. But it works only within the bounds of marriage. And the breakups are not emotionally free. They create bondage and brokenness and baggage galore. It's true. We could have a lot of testimonies about that. People would say sometimes, well, okay, but I don't know. Our culture is just saying that's not. Not my friends say, my prof said, or I read this here or that. Well, I'm talking God's word and God's standard today. And His desire and heart for us is to live clean today so that we can live clean in the future. We're not going to press a magic button, throw a magic button one day and be where we need to be. That's not what's going to happen. But here's the good news. No matter what your past has been, there's grace and mercy and forgiveness available. And it's not just that. You know, we think about what your past has been, but that's also about your presence. There's hope today, but we've got to be willing to do it God's way. Now, we have free will. We never have to do it God's way. There'll be a day of reckoning. He's not going to strike us dead. There'll be a day of reckoning. But know that. So important. I love the scripture that says of followers of Christ in 2 Timothy 5:17, anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and the new life has begun. When I meet with couples and they want me to marry them, I always inquire because I don't know what's going on with them, and there's just all kinds of combinations of things, and I don't back them into a corner, but I let it be clear and said, I'll tell you what, I'm not going to investigate, but you guys have to talk about this, and you have to look me in the eye and tell you the truth. I'm going to say that if I'm going to marry you from this day forward, you must abstain from sexual activity with each other, period. If you don't want me to marry you, that's fine, but that's my standard, and if you're living together, the same is true. You got to separate. Do it to honor God. Now, I've had people get angry at me, people not walk out. I've had all kinds of responses. but I live for the times where people have said, looking back, it's unbelievable what happened in our life. That was a turning point because we'd just been so careless, and we came to God and we confessed and repented and we said, we're going to do it your way from this day forward. And they said, I want to thank you because our life has changed. They said, for the first time, there's a measure of purity in our relationship that we never had. God's ways still work. I've experienced that many times. Finally, there's just such an entitlement attitude. I'm still talking about why some of these things are on the rise. Delayed gratification is out and instant gratification is in. You know, I want what I want and I want it right now. So let's talk about staying pure. And I want to talk about it from outward purity and inward purity. And I just remind you of this to preface it. It's true of almost all spiritual things. When people tell you that something has to happen to you outside the end, almost always question it. God works from the inside out. Yeah, there are outward manifestations of things from time to time, but it's always an inside thing. God starts on the inside because this is a heart-driven message. So let's talk a little bit about outward purity. Ephesians 5, 3 and 4. Let there be no sexual immorality, impurity, or greed among you. Such sins have no place among God's people. Did you hear that? Such things have no place among God's people. Obscene stories, foolish talk, coarse jokes, these are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. Don't you love it? The Bible just said, that's a problem. Here's what to do about it. Let your heart, your mind be full of thankfulness to God. I love the NIV translation of this. It uses the phrase, let there not be even a hint of sexual sin. Not a hint. God wants the best for us. He's not against us. He's for us. He's not out to destroy our fun and our joy. He wants our lives to be the best they can be, not polluted and destroyed and poisoned by sin that is so deadly over time, that is so common. I remember when Hillary was getting ready to, before she went to college, I remember having her book. I think the one I had you read was Every Young Man's Battle or something like that, and we interacted about it, but the conversation was that, man, when you're getting ready to date somebody at college, make sure as quickly as you can to find out about their purity level, to find out what's going on their life. Where are they about with pornography and things like that? We can't take these things for granted. They are way, 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 way too important. So not even a hint of sexual sin. Just let me give you some examples. It's not a conclusive list, but just some ideas. Okay, this is God's standard. Sexual sin is having sexual activity with someone who is not your spouse. Period. Period. Looking at any type of pornography, any type. Lusting after another guy or girl, whatever the case may be, dressing seductively and provocatively in order to draw the eyes, and you're really to draw lust from someone. Here's one. Sharing secrets and forming emotional ties, not with your spouse. You know what I'm talking about. You know when you've crossed the line talking to someone, not your spouse, about something intimate that should only be shared with you and your spouse. Are you with me? You know. You know the Holy Spirit convicts you. The beauty of intimacy of marriage, as I often say, is we have all kinds of secrets with each other, but no secrets from each other. It's always the secrets that we keep from each other that are destructive. Always. The best marriages that I know and see are those who listen and talk to one another regularly. Reading sexually and viewing sexually explicit materials like something like 50 Shades of Grey. And I included that because we don't realize how when we do these things, we can do it and get away with it, but we're poisoning our life and our relationships and our expectations and setting up all kinds of false standards that a spouse can never live up to because they're airbrushed. Gray is drab and deadly, and when I think of God, I don't think of gray. I don't think of Shades of Gray at all. Proverbs admonishes us in 5:8 to stay away from her. Not wisdom, as it talks in earlier chapter, but to stay away from a promiscuous woman. He said, don't go near the door of her house. Be strong and brave. You know what the best thing to do if you're strong and brave is? Is to run away. I call it doing the Joseph. For those of you that may not know the story, that's about Joseph. He was kidnapped and sold. He was sold by his brothers to Egypt. And there he was doing his best to be a man of integrity. And the Bible said he was well-built and handsome. And Mrs. Potiphar got the hots for him. And she tried to put the moves on him when Mr. Potiphar was gone. And she intensified it. And one day she grabbed hold of him. And the Bible says he literally ran away and left her holding his garment. Now, we know she made up a lie and all that. She started fake news and all that. That happened. But we need to do the Joseph. Maybe some of you will get this better. Run, Forrest, run! By the way, Forrest should have run away from Jenny. Yeah. Do the Joseph. Oh, that's a cowardly thing. No. Sometimes the best thing you can do. I mean, if I see a poisonous snake, I'm not Crocodile Dundee. I'm out of there. That's the most intelligent thing I can do. You got it. Run. Have you done the Joseph lately? That's not a sign of weakness. That's a sign of strength. It's a sign of strength to know where your weaknesses are. And here's another thing. And this is where Dixie and I had so many struggles, because I wouldn't open up to her about my weaknesses. I thought it was a strong, silent type. I would have been far better to just open up more about my feelings, because gals generally are so understanding. And by the way, let's not wait till we get caught. Let's address it ahead of time. Because you know what? If we get caught, our spouse is going to go, I wonder if they ever would have come clean if they wouldn't have gotten caught. Now, whatever, there's grace, God's mercy and forgiveness. I know that's there available. But I'm telling you, the best thing is to come clean before, with God and with each other. Okay. Now, some of you could be sitting there, and I don't know everybody's background spiritually. Some of you could be, this man crazy. Who does he think he is? That's so outdated and antiquated. And I want to say to you that people who are not following Jesus, people in the world, we have no right to hold them to a standard of what followers do. You follow what I'm saying? I mean, in other words, we shouldn't expect people of the world to act like followers of Jesus, and there should be a big difference. Not, I'm better than you, anything like that, but just the light of our life should be there. Are you with me on that? Help me out. It's lonely up here today. This is the tough one. But I am saying that when you become a follower of Jesus, when you say yes to Jesus, nobody holds a shotgun to your head. Nobody says, you got to do this. You choose by faith. You say yes to Jesus. You have a new life. You are representing him. You're following Jesus, and that changes everything. The Bible says in Romans, you do not belong to yourself. He owns you because you surrendered. So 1 Corinthians 6:19 says, don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price, so you must honor God with your body. Pretty clear, isn't it? That's why we're fixing to celebrate Good Friday and Palm Sunday and Easter, because it reminds us that we're not our own. God loves us so much, he's saying, don't go near, stay away from danger, run. All it's going to do is lead to regret. If only, I wished I wouldn't have. I won't read it, but in Matthew 5, 29 and 30, Jesus is talking about it, and it sounds very serious. He's saying, you know, if there's sin, deal with it drastically, and that's what he's telling us here. Deal drastically. Have zero tolerance when it comes to even a hint of sexual immorality. Some other practical thoughts here. Be careful about being alone and isolated and out of sight with someone who is not your spouse. You're just asking for trouble. Do you have somebody that you're accountable to that you can really be honest, that'll ask you tough questions and you will absolutely answer honestly? There are things you can install and blocks and guards you can get on your computers and devices. Are you willing to use those kind of things or not yet? And I'll say again, refuse to have intimate conversations with people that are not your spouse. I touched on that before. I heard another couple of guys lately, just gals in a panel discussion recently, and they said, one of the things that we make sure, we share all of our passwords. My husband, my wife has absolute access. I have nothing, they can have my phone, they can go anywhere they want on my files. Nothing is off limits to them. Why should it be? Why should it be off limits to them? I heard this one too, I thought this was really good. you know, in the days where you never know when you're going to be filmed, somebody might be shooting film of you on their phone and all that. They said, that's a good example. When it comes to your spouse thinks, are you doing anything this day, if filmed, that you would feel uncomfortable playing it back for them? Any involvement, any kind of interaction, would you feel totally comfortable with them watching the movie of your life for that day, every moment? That's a good one, isn't it? That's a good one. All right. You could make that list better, I'm sure. But I want to say again that setting boundaries is a sign of strength. That's wisdom, for sure. Another thing that I've thought of that I've heard some discussion about recently, and I know, I'm not trying to be legalistic because sometimes it can't happen, but how many times, you know, we need to start going to bed at the same time as spouses. What happens is, and I know there's shift changes and all that, but I'm talking as a rule when it's possible, because what happens, you know, you leave one, you go to bed, you're tired, and the other stays up, and that's when they start surfing, channel surfing, they get on social media, and that's just a playground for the enemy when you're alone at night. Okay, I just threw that in for free. That's a good one. And I'll just add this one, too. I think I noted it later, but, you know, I think one of the things that gets us, I'll just speak to the guys. I don't know about girls, but just channel surfing all the time. You know, we need to, it's okay to watch things, but make your watching intentional. How many times are we just channel surfing it? And that's again, a way to give Satan a threshold, a foothold in our lives. Does that make sense? So plan. As a part of running away from evil, plan that. Okay, well, let's be vulnerable with our spouse. Let's keep the door of temptation. Let's run away from it whenever we can. And I know it comes at us, but finally, I just want to talk about inward purity. Our best efforts at purity aren't man-made, because our best efforts are destined to fail, and it all comes down to purity as a matter of heart. It's heart-driven, love-driven. It's about submission. It's about the Holy Spirit. It's about what they sang about, resurrection power. Where? Living on the... So if he could do that, and if he could do the empty, can't he keep us clean? Yeah, he can. Are we willing to allow him? Are we willing to work with him? Are we willing to submit our will to his? That's what it's all about. Our will. 119, Psalm 119, 9 and 10. How can a young person stay pure? By obeying your word. How can a young person stay clean? And it reads on, by obeying your word. Don't let me wander from your commands. It finishes up. So David promises, the psalmist promises to seek God with all of his heart, to get God in his heart and life. That's our remedy. Get God's word in our heart and life, and not to drink the poison of sin, that we'll know the truth, and that truth will set us free from the inside out. Heart purity matters. It matters. Jesus was speaking about drawing those lines, and he said, it sounds radical in 5:28 of Matthew, but I say anyone who even looks at a woman, or we could put it in there, or a man with lust, has already committed adultery with her, with him in her heart, because it's an inside-outside thing. My dad was a preacher for 43 years, and I remember him from time to time with different applications telling about the king that was going to hire a chariot driver. And so they went to a treacherous passageway in the mountains, and they tried to impress him with their driving skill, and several just got closer and closer to the edge. And then finally one came that hugged the wall. Guess which one he hired? He hired the one that hugged the wall. I love it. Lust is a heart thing, and you could define it better, but it means I want to, I would like to. If I had the opportunity, I would. Their sin is birthed in the heart from the inside out, even if it hadn't been manifest. So we need to get his word into us, because it'll create a holy friction and a tension that'll rise up when the enemy's trying to draw us in like a harmless creature into a trap. Powerful, powerful. I have hidden your word in my heart, 119:11, that I might not sin against who? You. I have hidden your word, O God. I'm taking it in my life so that I might not sin against you. I love that passage. Oh, my friends, don't allow the world's influences to creep into your home or set your standard of purity. Plan ahead of time to avoid evil, to run. Do the Joseph as soon as possible, as much as possible. Stay close to Jesus because his presence illuminates sin. I mean, light exposes darkness, does it not? It drives darkness away. Know that purity totally matters in the future with your marriage and with your family. Start now. God loves us and has called us out of that love to be holy, set apart, his totally, pure in our thoughts, attitudes, words, and actions. And I want to hit on this, and again, be so careful. Guard your home. Don't allow evil to exert influence in our lives and homes. We can cut it off at the pass. As Barney Fife used to say, nip it in the bud. You wouldn't believe how many times I hear something like this, people justifying or defending their actions. Well, I have this friend, but we're just talking. We're just good friends. And I pause, and then I go, that's the problem! Your spouse needs to be your friend like that. Be careful about crossing the line. Well, when we respond to impurity around the corner here, there's different ways we can. If there's defensiveness, there's a problem. Why would you get defensive? Rationalize, blame somebody else. No, we never are beyond and above inspection and correction that we need. Hiding is never good. Come out of hiding. There's remorse. You know when I see remorse mostly? I'm sorry I got caught. Not talking about that. Don't like the consequences. I'll beat myself up and, oh, what a horrible wretch I am. Or third, there's actually humble repentance. Sincere sorrow that looks like Psalm 51, against you and you alone have I sinned, O God. We repent before God. We repent before our spouse. We make things right. I've sinned. I'm sorry. I want to be forgiven. I want to be transformed, God, by your power and grace. And there's mercy and grace available because you've not gone too T-O-O far. Your past is not too horrible. Your present isn't too horrible. That God's grace can't turn you around and say from this day forward, things are going to be different by his power, by his strength, and by his might. And could I just say this? Have you created the atmosphere so that your spouse can open their heart and tell you about the struggles without you coming down on them? Could you respond with grace and repentance and forgiveness? The power of forgiveness is amazing from God and man, what that can release. It takes great courage to come clean. And again, I am for you as your pastor. I just want you to do it God's way. From this day forward, I know the past has to be dealt with. It needs to be forgiven if it's been honored by God. There is forgiveness and grace, but going forward, it can be different from this day forward. If I didn't believe that, I would quit what I'm doing. That repentance is like 2 Corinthians 7:10, the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin. It's a heart thing. Not a law thing, not a legalistic thing, away from sin, and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. It's not like, sorry. It's deep. God, I want to honor you. Okay, we're at the end. I've been telling you lately, I think we need to stop praying, take that prayers, and we need to start praying more. Lord, I give you this. I give you my heart. Do you understand the difference? Oh, God, just make it better. Take it away. Take it away. Well, he can do that. But, you know, it's hard for him to take it away when we're hanging on. Who was it, Augustine, that I quoted, a church father from years gone by, when he was dealing with the sin and lust in his life, particularly sexual immorality, he said, Lord, make me pure, but not yet. I'm paraphrasing. Like, hang on. No, it's when we are willing to release it and let go. That's when God will step in. He's not going to yank it away against our will. He will not revoke your free will ever, ever. Let me close. You know how I am in stories. So a man and his wife were in the bedroom, and he was flopped out on the bed, and she was in front of the mirror in the bathroom during her nightly rituals, whatever you do, ladies, in your nightly rituals. And there's a big mirror there, you know, doing all this thing with the light. So he was there, exhausted, channel surfing, just going from one channel to another. And he got to one channel where there was something going on with some attractive, scantily clad woman in that case. And he stayed there for a good while and then went on. And after a while, his wife came out quietly, not yelling or anything, but she said, honey, why did you hesitate on that one channel? She had seen the TV in the mirror. She wasn't spying, it just was there. And he started, but the remote got stuck. No, I did. I did. And then she said, she asked him one question that's really stuck with me. She said, was it worth it? He said, no. Here's my prayer that not on the back end when we've given in, but on the front end we can say and ask ourselves, will it be worth it? Is it worth it? No. 1,000 times, no. I've never found in any form disobedience in my life before the Lord that it was ever worth it. There's been no disobedience in my life that I haven't regretted ever. Ever. Could we ask that question on the front side of temptation? Oh, dear ones, my heart says, will you do it God's way? Doing it your own way, is it worth it? Some of you don't know the payments that are going to come due later because you're not doing it God's way now. Would you move in a different direction? Here's what I know. 1 John 1:9 says, and I believe with all my heart, if we confess our sins to him, and that's what they are, and we got to call it what it is, we can't let our culture whitewash it, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, all wickedness. No exceptions. Look at me. There's nothing you've done or doing that is unforgivable when we come humbly before him in confession and repentance and say, from this day forward, I'm going to do it God's way. Don't go beating yourself up today. Oh, I've blown it now. There's always hope with God. Purity can be restored on the inside. Would you receive it as a gift from him? Guard your heart. That's where the battle rages. And guard your time and attention. Invest that wisely. Guard against those influences that we talked about. Run from them. Guard your kids as best you can. Guard comparisons to other people. And guard your home. Don't allow the enemy to get a foothold. Don't allow him to get a foot in the door. But throw him out. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to sit here quietly in the closing moments of the service. Dixie and I are going to sing. We're going to sing a song based on Psalm 139. I think it's 17, 18. You can open your Bible or phone and you can follow the gist for that. But because I want this message to be bathed in God's love. Look at me. He loves you. He knows you've messed up. He knows you've sinned, but he loves you and he's reaching out to you because he's saying, taste and see that the Lord is good. My way is right. And as we sing this morning, Dixie's going to join me. The altars are always open for you to pray. These are tough ones because people are going to think I'm this or that. Well, I wish we could get over that. The altars, the front, is just a wonderful place to pray. Maybe some couples just need to come forward and say, we're going to do God's way. We've had a hint of sexual immorality. We've been careless, or I've been careless. And God, I want to raise the standard. I'm going to go back and I'm going to set some guidelines so that I don't fall over the edge. And I'm not going to set it on the edge. I'm going to set them back here. And I'm going to hide God's word in my heart. So whatever action the Holy Spirit, but would you respond? A message like this is going to fall flatter than a flitter unless you take it and you process it in your heart. I encourage you. I think it's happening about this message series. We're dialoguing, and oh, how we need to do that. Talk about it. Why do we close off in this area? This is so important, and it's real for everybody. These are flesh and blood realities that we deal with. So would you just sit here quietly? We're going to sing about the power and depth of God's love. Would you just soak it in? If you can pray where you are, if you feel prompted to do so, even while we're singing, feel free, but be obedient.
many snowflakes fall in valleys deep on mountains tall. Would I understand if I'd count them all? How great are his thoughts towards me?
No human mind can know the full extent of the love God shows. He reached so far, he stooped so low to give all his love for me. Oh, how much he cares for me. Oh, how great his heart must be. There's no number high enough to count the Father's thoughts of love. More than all the grains of sand or stars above. How much he cares for you. How much he cares for me. How great his love. How great his heart must be.
My burdens, great or small, are his concern. He sees them all. He hastens to my faintest call. How great is his love for me.
The millions may pray to him, still he answers each of them. The youngest child, the oldest man, are precious before his eyes. Oh, how much he cares for me. Oh, how great his heart must be.
There's no number high enough to count the Father's thoughts of love. More than all the grains of sand or stars above. How much he cares for you. How much he cares for me. How great his love. How great his heart must be.
Respond to, but
again, the altars are always open. Just a wonderful place to pray. Just say, God, I want to do it your way. Father, thank you for these wonderful people. Some of the finest people I know in the world are right here in this room today. And I thank you for them. We want to represent you very well. We want the light of Jesus to show brightly in our lives. This is love-driven message. It's not about the law and legalism. It's not about you not forgiving us and throwing us on the spiritual scrap heap. It's that there's hope from this day forward if you will do it your way. I pray that dialogue will happen in families, for young adults, for teens, again, whatever level, Lord, around family tables. May we talk about this that is so important, that we honor you. Setting boundaries, being willing to do the Joseph, the strength and run from temptation that would grab us and draw us in and try to destroy our lives, our purity that is a gift from you. Extend your grace and forgiveness and mercy to all. May they not beat up on ourselves, but say, from this day forward, we're going to do it God's way. We're making a mark in the sand. May your blessing be unleashed upon these precious people in ways that we've never seen before. May next Sunday we gather together for a culmination of this series, and may we see you do something terrific in lives as we talk about the hope that comes when we say we're never giving up, we're never quitting. You're good, you're gracious, you're kind, you're full of mercy and grace. We love you. Thank you for the attentiveness today, and we've not just listened with our ears, but we've opened our hearts to the truth of your word. Speak to us in ways, surprising ways, when our head hits the pillow tonight. May we sense your gentle whisper saying, this is the way. Walk in it. I love you, my son, my daughter. I love you. Don't settle for less. Don't settle for less. We pray these things confidently in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. When you want to go, you're free to go. Again, if you want to pray, the altars are open.